Let us read a portion of that psalm which we just sang, Psalm 89. We read the first 37 verses. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. With my mouth will I make known thy faithfulness to all generations. For I have said, mercy shall be built up forever. Thy faithfulness shalt thou establish in the very heavens. I have made a covenant with my chosen. I have sworn unto David my servant. Thy seed will I establish forever, and build up thy throne to all generations. And the heavens shall praise thy wonders, O Lord, thy faithfulness also in the congregation of the saints. For who in the heaven can be compared unto the Lord? Who among the sons of the mighty can be likened unto the Lord? God is greatly to be feared in the assembly of the saints, and to be had in reverence of all them that are about him. O Lord God of hosts, who is a strong Lord like unto thee? Or to thy faithfulness round about thee? Thou rulest the raging of the sea. When the waves thereof arise, thou stillest them. Thou hast broken Rahab in pieces, as one that is slain. Thou hast scattered thy enemies with thy strong arm. The heavens are thine, the earth also is thine. As for the world and the fullness thereof, thou hast founded them. The north and the south thou hast created them. Tabor and Hermon shall rejoice in thy name. Thou hast a mighty arm. Strong is thy hand, and high is thy right hand. Justice and judgment are the habitation of thy throne. Mercy and truth shall go before thy face. Blessed is the people that know the joyful sound. They shall walk, O Lord, in the light of thy countenance. In thy name shall they rejoice all the day, and in thy righteousness shall they be exalted. For thou art the glory of their strength, and in thy favour our horn shall be exalted. For the Lord is our defence, and the Holy One of Israel is our King. Then thou spakest in vision to thy Holy One, and saidst, I have laid help upon one that is mighty. I have exalted one chosen out of the people. I have found David my servant, with my holy oil have I anointed him. With whom my hand shall be established, my arm also shall strengthen him. The enemy shall not exact upon him, nor the son of wickedness afflict him. And I will beat down his foes before his face, and plague them that hate him. But my faithfulness and my mercy shall be with him, and in my name shall his horn be exalted. I will set his hand also in the sea, and his right hand in the rivers. He shall cry unto me, Thou art my Father, my God, and the rock of my salvation. Also I will make him my firstborn higher than the kings of the earth. My mercy will I keep for him forevermore, and my covenant shall stand fast with him. His seed also will I make to endure forever, and his throne all the days of heaven. If his children forsake my law, and walk not in my judgments, if they break my statutes, and keep not my commandments, then will I visit their transgression with the rod, and their iniquity with stripes. Nevertheless, my loving kindness will I not utterly take from him, nor suffer my faithfulness to fail. My covenant will I not break, nor alter the thing that has gone out of my lips. Once have I sworn by my holiness that I will not lie unto David. His seed shall endure forever, and his throne as the sun before me. It shall be established forever as the moon, and as a faithful witness in heaven. Thus far, read God's holy word. What is a friend? We all have friends. For most of us, our closest friends are our family, a man's wife, a wife's husband, a child's parents or siblings, a parent's children are usually friends. We are close to our friends. We enjoy their company. We share, to a certain degree, our life with them. It is not so with other people in your life. Few of us would call the traffic warden, the bank manager, or even the person who serves them in the supermarket regularly their friend. We have some contact with such people. We might know something about them, but that's as far as it goes. But what is friendship? Friendship has at least three aspects to it. First, friends have affection, even love, often deep love for one another. They are drawn towards one another. They delight in one another. They esteem one another highly. Think of the great example of friendship in the Old Testament, David and Jonathan. 1 Samuel 18 tells us the first time of the friendship of David and Jonathan. And it came to pass, verse 1, when he had made an end of speaking unto Saul, that the soul of Jonathan was knit with the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul. And then, when Jonathan is killed in battle, David laments his death and says, his love was better than the love of women. 2 Samuel 1, verse 26. Second, friends have intimate knowledge of one another because they share with one another. They do this because they have a genuine interest in one another. They trust one another. Again, David and Jonathan are a great example of this. They shared the experiences of life. David would tell Jonathan things which he would tell no one else because he knew he could trust Jonathan. And Jonathan would not betray David even to his own father. Friends, therefore, have no secrets from one another. Between friends, true friends, there is genuine, fruitful communication. This is a mutual knowledge. Friends talk to one another. Friends pour their hearts out to one another. It would be a very strange friendship indeed. If you said, so-and-so is my friend, well, I never talk to him. I never answer his phone calls. I never respond to his letters. I really have no interest in him at all. And I spend no time with him at all. What kind of friend would that be? Third, in friendship, there is a sharing of life. Close friends, such as husband and wife, live together. Friends delight to be with one another. They enjoy spending time together. There is a closeness between friends. They eat together. They walk together. They are wrapped up in one another's lives. According to Scripture, it is God's goal and purpose to have friendship with his people in Jesus Christ. And the whole of the history of the Bible is really the story of God's friendship with his people as that friendship unfolds and develops throughout history until it is perfected in the new heavens and the new earth. And God's relationship with his people is friendship. Close, intimate, sweet friendship in love. And in this friendship, there is mutual affection and love. God loves, God delights in, God treasures and blesses his people. In his goodness to them, God showers them with unspeakably great blessings, the forgiveness of their sins, peace with God, everlasting righteousness, and finally, everlasting life in heaven itself. And in return, God's people respond as his friends in love. They respond in thankfulness and joy. There's knowledge too in this friendship. God knows his people with a perfect knowledge. He searches his people. He has a deep knowledge of affection for his people. And he reveals himself to his people. He tells them who he is. He tells them his name. He reveals to them his purposes and his will. And his people respond by saying, "Tell me more, Lord. I would know more about thee." And he gives his people the enormous privilege of coming to him in prayer. And his people then sing his praises, confess their sins, and worship him in true love. He loves them, and they love him in return. And with God's friendship, there is a sharing of life. God not only tells us how blessed his life is, he shares that life with us. He takes us into that blessed life so that we taste and know that he is good. We walk with him, he dwells with us, and we dwell with him, and we will live with him forever. That's friendship. That's the best possible friendship. The Bible has a word to describe this friendship, and you probably all know what that word is. Covenant. The covenant is very important in Scripture. The word covenant appears over 300 times. The Bible is divided according to God's covenant, because covenant means testament. Testament means covenant. Old Testament, New Testament, the covenant. And the covenant is a bond of friendship which God establishes with his people in Jesus Christ. And many have missed this because a popular conception of the covenant is not a bond of fellowship and friendship with God, but rather an agreement, a contract between God and man, where there are conditions, where man must fulfill certain requirements in order to be and in order to remain the friend of God. Many believe that God made an agreement or entered into a contract with Israel in the Old Testament, and Israel was not able to keep that covenant or agreement because of her sin. Then God scrapped that old covenant, rejected Israel as a people, and entered into a new and different covenant or agreement with a new people, the Gentiles. And then they say that God will come back to Israel in the future and reestablish his covenant, his agreement, and then they will accept the terms of that agreement. Is that your understanding of the word covenant in Scripture? An agreement, a conditional bargain with God. If it is, I ask you to listen carefully and to compare what I say this evening with the Word of God. If a person imagines that the covenant is an agreement or a contract or a bargain, then he misses much of the beauty of the Scriptures. He misses the truth that the covenant is friendship with God. A covenant friendship which God determines, which God establishes, which God maintains, and which God perfects, and a covenant friendship which God's people will enjoy forever. And the position I defend this evening, therefore, is this. There is one covenant, and its essence is friendship with God. Notice first, the covenant is God's covenant. It's God's covenant. In the Bible, it's referred to as His covenant. Over 50 times in the Bible, the phrase, "My covenant," appears. And God comes to His people and He simply declares words like these: "I will establish my covenant between me and thee," or "between me and you," plural. Or, "I will remember my covenant with you," or "I will make my covenant." Never does God say, "Let us make a covenant together. Let us sit down and hammer out an agreement, the terms of a bargain." And never does God say, "Our covenant." Always, "My covenant." We see that in the so-called covenant formula in Scripture. The formula goes like this: "I will be your God, and you will be my people." Or, "I will be their God, and they shall be my people." Or, "I will make a covenant with thee to be a God unto thee." God simply comes to His people in the Bible and declares to them, "This is how it's going to be. I have chosen to enter into a covenant relationship with you." He does not say, "Would you like to be my people? Would you like to be my friends? Would you like to enter into an agreement with me? If you do, here are the stipulations." Rather, He said to Adam, "I am your God. Know me. Love me. Walk with me. Serve me." He came to Abraham in these words: "I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be thou perfect, and I will make my covenant between me and thee." Genesis 17, verse 1. And notice, one covenant. Never does God say, "My covenants," plural. And when He seems to make a new covenant with Abraham, or with Israel, or with David, or the new covenant of the New Testament people of God, it is not a brand new covenant. It is essentially the same covenant. God does never scrap His old covenant, His former covenant, and start anew. He continues and develops His one covenant. It's the same covenant of friendship. And I will show that as we proceed this evening. In this covenant, God comes to His people with promises and He swears an oath. He comes to His people and says to them, "I will bless you exceedingly, and you will be my people. As your God, I will give unto you, and I will be unto you, everything that a God gives and is to His people. I will be faithful and true. I will love you freely. I will provide for you. I will give you life with me. I will share my life with you. We will dwell together in love. You will taste and you will see that I, the Lord God, am good." And God promises that He will never break His covenant. We read that in Psalm 89. Verse 30, "If His children forsake my law and walk not in my judgments, if they break my statutes and keep not my commandments, then will I visit their transgression with the rod and their iniquity with stripes." Oh yes, there will be chastisement for those who do not obey God. But read on. "Nevertheless, My loving kindness will I not utterly take from him, nor suffer my faithfulness to fail. My covenant will I not break, nor alter the thing that has gone out of my lips. Because his covenant friendship with his people is from everlasting to everlasting. And when we sin against him and his friendship, and when we betray him in this friendship, he does not say, now you've sinned too much, I will cast you off, I will take to myself another people, but rather he says, I will forgive you. Again and again, I will forgive you. I will chastise you, I will beat you with rods, but I will restore you to myself through that chastisement. I will never cast you off. You will be my people. I will never, ever let you go. God will therefore never cast off his people or destroy his people. God will never say concerning his people, I'm fed up with this miserable, wretched, disobedient people. They're not good enough to be my friends. I try to have a friendship with this people, but they show themselves to be too stubborn and stiff-necked to be my friends. I will look for other friends. No, he remembers that we are dust. He remembers that we are miserable sinners besides. And his purpose is to deliver us from our sin, so that we dwell with him in sinless perfection, in heavenly bliss forever. And so the covenant can never be an agreement, a contract, or a bargain between God and man. Because remember, we're talking here about a friendship with God. Yes, man, as equals, can sit down together and make an agreement. They can get around the bargaining table, as it were, and can hammer out the terms of an agreement mutually agreed by both parties. You do that if you're entering into a business agreement with someone. Man can agree to fulfill certain conditions and stipulations. And that was true in the Bible as well, between men. They entered into covenants, and those covenants were agreements, and those agreements were conditional agreements. But God does not enter into an agreement with man, because man is a creature of the dust, and man is a sinner besides. God never comes to a sinner and says, okay, here is our agreement. I will promise to give unto you eternal life if you agree to believe on me, if you accept the terms of this agreement, if you obey me faithfully, then you will have eternal life. If you don't, you lose what you could have had in this agreement. He doesn't even come to us in the New Testament with easier terms than those. Okay, I see that perfect lifelong obedience, which was a requirement under the law, was too strict. So now I have modified the agreement to suit your weakness. Now the new condition is faith. All you have to do is to believe. Believe on me, and I will be your God. That's not the covenant either. God and man are not equals. And besides, man cannot perform any conditions to merit eternal life. And the most fundamental reason why the covenant is not an agreement is that the covenant is a reflection of the life of God himself. The source of the covenant, the source of friendship with God, is the fact that God himself has friendship within himself. Why is their friendship, why is their family life in the world? Have you ever thought about that? Have you ever wondered why society, human society, is made up of families and friends? Why no man, as they say, is an island? Why human beings need other human beings to have friendship and fellowship with? Is it because we have evolved from social animals who evolved from other social animals? No. It's because our Creator himself is a God of fellowship and friendship. And therefore, he created man and woman to be in fellowship with one another. He created human beings who are capable of having fellowship with one another and with him. God is the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. He lives within himself a perfect life of fellowship. In heaven, there are not three business associates around a bargaining table, but rather a father who loves his son and a son who loves his father in the Holy Spirit. A close-knit family of perfect persons. The Bible says that the Son is in the bosom of the Father. Pressed into the bosom of the Father in a position of love, not around a bargaining table. Jesus describes his position with respect to the Father as being in the Father. Several times he says that, "Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works." God's life, then, is one of the deepest love, for God is love. His life is one of intimate communion and knowledge. The Father and the Son share their lives completely. They have no secrets from one another. They have a perfect knowledge of love with one another. Here's how Proverbs 8:30 describes it. "Then I was by him, as one brought up with him, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing always before him." That's the life of God within himself, a beautiful life of family. And it was God's purpose then, his eternal purpose, to reveal this blessed life of family, of friendship, to his people, and to take us into that life of friendship, so that we would taste it and know it and experience it and know the joy of it forever. That was God's purpose. Not to have an agreement with us, but to share his life with us, to give us a taste of his perfect friendship. The Bible, therefore, speaks of the covenant in its very essence as friendship with God. Now, there are several lines of proof for this. First of all, the Bible explicitly says that God's people are his friends. Abraham was God's friend. So when God entered into a covenant with Abraham, it was a relationship of friendship. Here's what godly King Jehoshaphat prays to God many centuries after the death of Abraham in 2 Chronicles 20, verse 7. "Art thou not our God, who didst drive out the inhabitants of this land before thy people Israel, and gavest it to the seed of Abraham thy friend forever?" As far as Jehoshaphat is concerned, Abraham was and Abraham is, and Abraham always shall be, the friend of Jehovah God. James 2:23 says this, and the scripture was fulfilled, which saith, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. Moses too, of him we read, he spoke with the Lord, quote, as a man speaketh unto his friend. Exodus 33, verse 11. And this friendship language is not simply an Old Testament way of speaking. This is the way that Jesus Christ describes his people in the New Testament, showing us that the covenant is essentially the same in both Testaments. Look at John 15 for a moment. John 15, 13 to 15. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends, if ye do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. Because Christ is our friend, he makes known unto us the things that his Father has made known unto him. As I said, friends do not have secrets from one another. Friends share with one another. And that's what Jesus does with his friends. In John 11, verse 11, Jesus speaks of our friend Lazarus, that he is sick. In Matthew 11, verse 19, the Pharisees scornfully but accurately call him the friend of publicans and sinners. He was their friend. He was their savior, and therefore their friend. But the Pharisees couldn't understand such a thing. In Luke 12, verse 4, he speaks to his friends and warns them about the wrath of God. I say unto you, my friends. And in James 4, verse 4, we are warned that friendship with God requires us to be enemies of the world. You can't be a friend of God, and that's the essence of salvation in the New Testament. You can't be a friend of God if you're also a friend of the world. So friends. Second, God's people are his children. What is the relationship between a father and his children? Do fathers and children sit down around a bargaining table and make agreements? I will be your father if you do this and that and the other thing. And then I will allow you to be my son and live in my house under the following terms and conditions. No. No father does that. Fathers tell their children that they love their children. They promise to care for their children, and in response, children love their father. And Moses said this to Pharaoh, thus saith the Lord, Israel is my son, even my firstborn. And I say unto thee, let my son go, that he may serve me. Exodus 4, verse 22. In Psalm 103, verse 13, we read this, as a father pitieth his children, so the Lord pitieth them that fear him. In Jeremiah 31, verse 9, I am a father to Israel, and Ephraim is my firstborn. Malachi 3, 17, and they shall be mine, saith the Lord of hosts, in that day when I make up my jewels, and I will spare them, as a man spareth his own son that serveth him. It doesn't take much to prove that we are called the sons and daughters of God in the New Testament. Just one example, 2 Corinthians 6:18. Touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and my daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. Sons and daughters of God, not those who have entered into an agreement with God. And incidentally, an important aspect of God's covenant of friendship is his promise to include the children of believers in his friendship. This was true with Noah. This was true with Abraham. I will be a God unto thee and to thy seed after thee. This was true with Israel. They shall be my people, and I will be their God, and I will give them one heart and one way, that they may fear me forever for the good of them and of their children after them. Jeremiah 32, 38, and 39. God is so rich in mercy in this covenant of grace. He not only takes us to be his people, which is astounding in itself, but he takes our children too. He promises to us and to our children that he will be our God. He promises to save our children after us in our generations. And this promise remains in the New Testament as well. Acts 2:39, on the day of Pentecost, Peter says, the promise is unto you and to your children. Third, the teaching that God's people are his bride or his wife. And again, husbands and wives do not enter into a bargain or an agreement to be married. There are in the world such things as prenuptial agreements, but those are corruptions of marriage. The closest earthly friendship possible between human beings is marriage. And so close is God's friendship with his people that he calls it a marriage. In the Old Testament and the New Testament, God's relationship with his people is a marriage. It's a sharing of life together of a man and a woman. It's a living together in one house, dwelling together in love, becoming so close that they are called one flesh. And this union of marriage is even closer than the union of a mother with her children. That's how close marriage is. And God says of his people, they are not my junior partners in a business agreement. My wife, my spouse, I love her. I dwell with her in love. Here's Jeremiah 3, verse 14. Turn, O backsliding children, saith the Lord, for I am married unto you, and I will take you one of a city. Could quote many other passages, Ezekiel 16. The whole chapter speaks of the marriage of Jehovah and his people. Hosea 2, verse 19 speaks of this as well. And what is the outstanding sin of Israel in the Old Testament? Idolatry, worshipping other gods. And how is that sin portrayed? Adultery, harlotry, whoredom, spiritual fornication. Why? Because they are married to Jehovah. And when they follow after other gods, they are committing spiritual adultery. And we all know, of course, in the New Testament, the figure is the same. Jesus Christ is the husband of his church. The church is the bride of Christ. He is the long-awaited bridegroom, and one day he will take his bride of the Old Testament and the New Testament, one woman whom he has loved from eternity, to be with himself. And here is Paul in 2 Corinthians 11, verse 2. I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. And the book of Revelation tells us that heaven will be the marriage feast of the Lamb. Fourth, there is the teaching that God's people are his peculiar, treasured people. God does not view his people as business associates or junior partners. He views them as his beloved people. A weak, vulnerable, sinful people whom he rules as a gracious king. He views them as a flock of precious but defenseless sheep whom he shepherds and feeds and leads with gentleness. In the Old Testament, God shows his people and declares to them, Deuteronomy 7, verse 7, for example, Thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are upon the earth. And over and over and over again in the Old Testament, God says, My people, my people, my people, these are my people, and I am their God. Hebrews 11, verse 16 says, God is not ashamed to be called their God. Again, the same is true in the New Testament. Jesus comes to save, Matthew 1, 21, his people from their sins. Titus says that he gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity, and purify unto himself a peculiar people zealous of good works. Chapter 2, verse 14. Peter says this, But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. 1 Peter 2, 9 and 10. Now Peter there is quoting Hosea. Jesus is our shepherd, just as Jehovah God was the shepherd of his people in the Old Testament. Jesus is our gracious Lord and our King, and we are his beloved people. His friends, his children, his bride, his people. And since they are his friends, his children, his bride, and his people, they dwell together. And this is a recurring theme throughout the Holy Scriptures. Business associates do not dwell together in love and share their life together, but friends do. In the beginning, God created for himself friends, Adam and Eve. He made them a home, the Garden of Eden. He made them in his own image, so that they reflected in their creation something of God's perfections. He made them in knowledge, so that they knew God in love. They had a deep personal knowledge of their Creator. He made them in holiness, so that body and soul, Adam and Eve, as they were created, were devoted and consecrated to God, and were able and willing, and it was their delight to devote everything in the garden, in the whole creation, to the glory of God. He made them in righteousness, so that their whole life was directed in the way of God's commandments. Perfect harmony with the perfect and good will of their God. And how did he deal with them in the Garden of Eden? He came to them in the cool of the evening, after their day's work was done. He walked with them and he talked with them. He spoke to Adam and Eve about the wonders of his love, and they responded by loving him. And when in foolishness and rebellion, they sinned against him and hid from him because they followed after the devil, they chose friendship with Satan. God sought them out and promised to restore to them the friendship which they had lost. And how would he do that? By making them enemies of the devil. He said, I will put enmity between thee, the devil, and the woman, between her seed and thy seed. And by creating enmity between the devil and the seed of the woman, he was promising friendship between himself and the seed of the woman. And that was not the end of God dwelling with his people. He dwelt with them in paradise in the Garden of Eden. Later, in the history of the world, we read of God walking with individuals and those people walking with him. Enoch, Genesis 5, verse 22, and Noah, Genesis 6, verse 9, walked with God. That was a walk of friendship. Their lives were directed in paths of communion with God. As a man walks with his friend, so God's people walk with their God. Amos 3, verse 3 asks the rhetorical question, can two walk together except they be agreed? Of course they can. So walking with God means walking in agreement, agreeable to God, walking in ways which are pleasing to God, avoiding those ways which are hateful to God. And that's the way Enoch walked, and that's the way Noah walked, and that's the way every child of God is called to walk. So to frame his or her life, that they live and walk in harmony with God, loving him, serving him, obeying him, and avoiding sin which displeases him. And when these Old Testament saints of God sinned, and of course they did sin, they sought God in sorrow and brought a sacrifice to cover their sins. As a sign of the sacrifice that the seed of the woman, Jesus Christ, would offer for them one day. Later we're told that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob sojourned with God. They considered themselves to be pilgrims and strangers, different from the world around them, but yet living with God in love in the midst of a wicked world and looking forward to their heavenly home, of which Canaan was a picture. Later, we read of God's tabernacle and temple in the land of Canaan. Why did God give the Jews the land of Canaan? Why did God promise to Abraham and Abraham's seed a land? So that they would have a place where they could dwell with God in safety and in peace as his people. Remember, before this, God's people had only known the misery of slavery, the bondage of Egypt. But now God promises to them a rich inheritance in a land which flows with milk and honey, a land in which they can have fellowship with God himself. And every Israelite would have his own portion in that land, a lot given to him in inheritance. A picture and a token of the Canaan above. That's why Naboth would not sell his portion to Ahab. You remember the story in 1 Kings 21? Naboth had a vineyard close to the palace of King Ahab. Ahab liked Naboth's vineyard, thought it would make a good place to have a vegetable garden. He came to Naboth and offered him a different piece of land or some money for that land. And Naboth said, "God forbid that I should sell my inheritance to you, Ahab." But Ahab sulked. Jezebel had Naboth murdered, and then God brought judgment against Ahab. Why was Naboth so stubborn about his vineyard? Because that was his portion of land. He had received that from his fathers, and they had received that from God himself. And Naboth could sing as he worked his vineyard the words of Psalm 16, 5 and 6. "The Lord is the portion of my inheritance and of my cup. Thou maintainest my lot. The lines are fallen unto me in pleasant places." Perhaps the lines were only a small plot of land, but they fell to Naboth in pleasant places. "Yea, I have a goodly heritage." That's the reason Naboth prized his vineyard. And when Naboth was murdered and left his vineyard, and his sons were murdered after him, as the Bible tells us, he left his earthly inheritance, which was only a picture, and went to heaven to enjoy his heavenly Canaan, the everlasting reality of which his vineyard was only a dim reflection. On the other hand, of course, Ahab had a big plot of land, but he had no inheritance in the Canaan above because he was a wicked and unbelieving and reprobate man. And even before the people of Israel entered the land of Canaan, the Lord had Moses build an elaborate tent. And you can read all about the instructions to build this tent at the end of the book of Exodus. This tent was called the Tabernacle of the Lord. Leviticus 26:11 tells us the purpose for this tent. "I will set my tabernacle among you, and my soul shall not abhor you, and I will walk among you, and will be your God, and ye shall be my people." The tabernacle was God's house, and there he chose to dwell in the midst of his people Israel, in the midst of his covenant people. He gave precise instructions on how to build this tent, this house for the Lord. And God was pleased to dwell in the most holy place in the middle of this tent. And he gave instructions too on how he was to be approached, because you couldn't simply just walk into the most holy place. Oh no, because God is holy and God's people are sinners. So he gave them priests, and he gave them sacrifices, and he gave them the high priest. He gave them the Day of Atonement. He gave them other feast days. All of these were to show them how he could be approached. He dwelt in the midst of them, in the cloud of glory, above the Ark of the Covenant. No other God dwelt such a way with their people, but God was pleased to dwell in such a way with his people. And he went with them in this tabernacle throughout their wilderness wanderings. He never left them, And then when they got to Canaan, he had Solomon build for him a more permanent dwelling place. Not a tent, but a temple. A beautiful, elaborate temple. But there were limitations and imperfections in the way in which God dwelled with his people. God dwelled in the most holy place, but none of the people could actually approach him in the most holy place. Only one man was able to go there, and that only once a year, and not without blood, the high priest. Everyone else had to keep their distance, because the people had to know that yes, this is their friend, yes, he loves them, but they are sinners, and he is holy. And so they can't have that close fellowship which they desire and which God purposes that they have because of their sin. But something better was coming. In a way, you could say that this was like a husband and wife living together in one house, but yet they weren't in one room. There was a thick curtain dividing the husband from the wife, but the wife could not approach the husband. And once a year, the wife could send a message into the room of her husband. And this kind of fellowship, although better than living in two separate houses, was not close enough. And God promised a better and a closer relationship. And he promised that in Christ. And Christ's name is Emmanuel, God with us. Because in order for God's people to have fellowship with the Holy God, the barrier between God and his people, which is their sin, had to be overcome. God's holy and righteous character had to be satisfied. And this happened through the mediator, Jesus Christ. He stands between a holy God and a sinful people. And he brings them together so close now that God becomes man. He takes upon himself our human nature, and he never discards it again. He brings that human nature, our human nature, to heaven, and our flesh is now at the right hand of God. He is the fulfillment of the tabernacle and the temple. The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. John 1:18. Literally, the Greek is this, and the Word became flesh and tabernacled among us. He is the tabernacle. The earthly temple made with hands could never be satisfactory then. God would dwell among us. But more than that, God would dwell with us, Emmanuel. But more than that, God would dwell in us by the Holy Spirit. That's why the Bible says about the church that it is the temple of God. Not the building, but the people. They are. We are. Collectively, as the church of Jesus Christ, and individually, as Christians, we are the temple of God. 1 Corinthians 3:16. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? And Ephesians 2:19, speaking to the Gentiles, Paul writes, Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and the household of God. We are, Jews, Gentiles alike, the household of God. And when Christ died on the cross and rose again, he purchased for us the right to be the friends of God. And he purchased for us the right to have the Holy Spirit dwell in us. God dwells among us. God dwells with us. God dwells in us. The curtain was torn from top to bottom when Jesus Christ died. The way into the Holy of Holies has been opened, and we have boldness now to enter into the presence of God, which the people of the Old Testament could barely have dreamed of. And that temple will never be rebuilt. It's gone. It was pictured. It's no longer needed. Christ has come. We need no temple, because we are the temple. And one final dwelling place, heaven. Started off in paradise the first, Adam and Eve. Went through various manifestations of God dwelling with his people. The final and perfect dwelling with his people as friends will be heaven. Christ will return. He will take us all to be with himself in heaven. There the marriage will be consummated. There the marriage feast of the Lamb will take place, and God's people will enjoy his friendship forever. And here's Revelation 21, verse 3. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God." So who are then the friends of God? With whom does God make this covenant? With whom does God establish his bond of friendship? Not with all men, never with all men. In Noah's day, God established his covenant with one man and his family. And God set his face in anger and wrath against all other men upon the earth. And God does not even establish his covenant with all those who grow up in the sphere of the covenant. God does not establish his covenant with all the children of Adam. He did with Abel. He did with Seth. But Cain showed himself to be a seed of the serpent and not a friend of God. With Noah, God rejected Ham and especially his grandson Canaan. God did not establish his covenant with all of Abraham's line either. There was Ishmael. The line of Ishmael was rejected. All of Isaac's children, Esau, was cast off. Not all of Israel's descendants were the friends of God either, nor all of David's descendants. Many who lived among the people of God, among a people who were declared collectively to be God's people, were themselves never truly the friends of God. And Romans 9 verse 6 explains to us, "They are not all Israel which are of Israel." The nation as a whole was of Israel. But within that nation was an elect remnant, and they were the true Israel. Israel after the spirit, not Israel after the flesh. Ultimately, God established his covenant with Christ. Christ is God's true friend. Christ is the one God loves supremely, the one in whom God delights, and the one whose glory God seeks. Christ is the true seed of Abraham. Galatians 3, verse 16 tells us that. Christ is the true seed of David. Romans 1, 3, 2 Timothy 2, verse 8 shows us that too. And Psalm 89, which we read together, when God makes promises to the seed of David, he's making them not to every individual son of David. Many of the kings who came after David were wicked and ungodly, but he makes that promise to Christ. And in making that promise to Christ, he establishes his covenant of friendship with Christ and all those who are in Christ. And how do they show themselves to be in Christ? Through faith. Those who are of faith are the seed of Abraham. Which means, of course, that God was never a true friend to all the Jews. He was only a friend of elect, true Israel within the nation of Israel. Not all Israelites were friends of God. Naboth was a friend of God. Ahab was an enemy of God. The elect remnant within the nation of Israel were his friends. The unbelieving, reprobate Israelites lived in Canaan. They enjoyed many of the outward privileges of being Israelites, but they were never true Israelites at heart. God was never truly their God. They were never truly God's people. They hated the true God. They despised the benefits of that God. They trampled his covenant underfoot, and they perished. Let me conclude by way of summary. The covenant is one-sided or unilateral. It's not that God and man together decide to form a covenant. God conceived of this covenant in eternity. It's God's covenant. God makes the covenant. God establishes or causes the covenant to stand. And God perfects the covenant. Therefore, the covenant is unconditional. It's made with Christ, the elect one, and therefore with all those who are in Jesus Christ. Only with the elect, never with the reprobate. It never depends upon man, upon man's works, upon man's faith, upon man's faithfulness. It depends entirely upon God. Therefore, the covenant is gracious. No one deserves to be in the covenant of God. It's the highest expression of God's mercy to take his people, to be his people, and to enjoy his covenant friendship, to cause them to taste and to know that he is good. And the covenant is essentially friendship. It's an expression of God's love. It is God dwelling with his people in love. It is the intimate knowledge of God and his people in love. It's the sharing of God, his life, with his people in love. And there's no higher bliss than that. And our response to the covenant of God must be love and gratitude. Love this God. Walk with this God. Cling to this God and serve this God forever. Thank you. Does anyone have any comments or questions or reflections? they're all stunned.
You know the way the scriptures uses the expression breaking God's covenant? If the covenant doesn't depend on us and doesn't have any conditions, how can you break it?
Well, you don't break it in the sense of destroying it. You break it in the sense of violating it. And when, let's say Ahab, as an example of a reprobate Israelite, when Ahab worshipped Baal, he broke God's covenant. He showed that he despised the covenant which God had made with Israel. Even though God had not made a personal covenant with Ahab, and he showed that he hated God, and he therefore violated and trampled underfoot the friendship of God, which he knew, by being an Israelite, he knew what this friendship was, but he despised it. But it was never made with him personally. Anyone else? Nope. Hey, thank you for your attention. That was long.